Welcome back to the video lecture series on pattern recognition. This is Jyotsna Devi Vodapati, Assistant Professor, Department of CSE, Vigyan University. In the last few lectures, we have discussed few concepts related to the vectors, and then in the other lecture, we have discussed the concepts related to matrices. So in today's lecture, we'll be discussing what eigenvalues and eigenvectors are and how to compute eigenvalues and eigenvectors. The agenda of today's lecture is we will try to understand what eigenvalues and eigenvectors are. Then few examples we'll see given the matrix, how to identify eigenvalues and eigenvectors of the given matrix. Then we'll see what are diagonalizable matrices, then what are the properties of the diagonalizable matrices, and how to convert the given matrix into diagonalizable matrix, and then what is matrix decomposition, then what are the different ways to decompose the given matrix. There are basically two different ways that are very popular for decomposing the given matrix. So based on the eigenvectors and eigenvalues, you can decompose the matrix, and the other technique is based on the singular values. So we'll be discussing these two techniques of matrix decomposition in today's lecture. So let's start our lecture with the discussion on the linear transformation. So before understanding what the speciality of the eigenvectors is, we should understand what linear transformation is. So now consider the vector V, which is in the space of capital V. So vector V is in some space, and then it is transformed to other space, that is in the U space. So this transformation is happening with the help of the matrix M. And now this transformed matrix is represented in this space, projected space, that is U space. So this new vector will be changing the direction. So when you compare the original vector and this projected vector, so the direction is different, and also the magnitude of the vectors is also different. So that is what the transformation is. You are basically transforming a vector in one space to the other space. And how you are doing this transformation is with the help of the matrix. And the operation you are using for transforming the vector is U equal to MV. And MV is the matrix in the projected space. And the transformation you are applying is a linear transformation. So that is, you are basically applying M into V, which is a kind of linear transformation. Depending on the dimension of the vectors U and V, the dimensionality of the matrix M is decided. Say for example, U and V are the vectors of the same dimension, then so your matrix M, the transformation matrix M that is used, can be of the square type. If they are of different shapes, the U space is different from the dimensionality of the V space, then the matrix used for the transformation must be of the rectangular type. So it cannot be a square matrix. So that is how the matrix you are using for the transformation changes the dimensionality depending on the dimensions of the U space and V space. And then in pattern recognition, we are especially interested in transforming a vector V, which is of high dimensional space, to the vector U of the low dimensional space. So here you can consider V is of high dimensional and U is of the lower dimensional, and you are reducing the high dimensional vector to the lower dimensional vector with the help of the matrix M, and you are basically applying the linear transformation. And this kind of transformation is very, very important in pattern recognition, because in this way you can reduce the dimensionality of the features, so that you can reduce the number of operations, the number of computations you are performing in your pattern recognition systems. So while applying the pattern recognition system, basically you are processing the vectors and the matrices, right? So in that case, when you project your data, when you reduce your dimensionality from the high dimensional to the lower dimensional, so your size of the vectors will be reduced, so that the number of computations you need to do will be reduced consequently. So that is how linear transformation will be helpful in pattern recognition. Now let us consider this five vectors. So this is the original space, and matrix the vectors are numbered from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I have considered these five vectors in the original space. So this is the original space of the vectors. Now I am going to transform these five vectors with the using the matrix A. That is, I am applying basically the linear transformation. So now you can see the vector 1 is projected to the new space and the associated vector is A. So here if you observe, so the direction of the vector is changed when you compare from the original space. So in the original space, so it is very close to the y-axis. Here if you observe, here it's much far from the y-axis. That is how when you apply the linear transformation, so the direction of the vector changes. So usually that is how it happens when you apply the linear transformation. So when you apply linear transformation on any vector, so in general, so the direction of the, so here if you observe, the direction of the vector changes, and also there is a possibility of changing the magnitude of the vector. So here it's clearly visible in the case of the second vector. So the magnitude of the vector is also different. So that is how the linear transformation takes place in the case of the vectors. So the takeaway here is, so when you project the vectors from the original space to the some other space using the linear transformation, in general, so the magnitude of the vector changes and also the direction of the vector changes. But if you observe here in this case, so there is a special vector. So the same kind of transformation can be observed in other vectors. But in case of the vector 4, so there is no change in the direction and only the magnitude is changed. So such special types of vectors are called as eigenvectors. So even after the linear transformation is applied also, in case of the vector 4, that is a special vector, so where the direction is not changed even after applying this transformation, the linear transformation, only the magnitude of the vector is changing. So such a special type of vector is called as eigenvector. So now let's see in detail what is the eigenvector and eigenvalues are. So consider the given matrix of size n by n and consider a non-zero vector of V, and suppose that, so there is a lambda which is a scalar value, so usually a real value, and basically here we have a matrix A which is of n by n size, and we have a vector which is a non-zero vector, and we have a lambda and it satisfies the equation AV equal to lambda V. So in that case, so if any matrix and vector that satisfies this equation, so you can say such a vector V is a eigenvector for the matrix A. And so lambda is the eigenvalue associated with the vector V. So that is how the eigenvalue and eigenvector can be defined. Here in this case, our lambda value is greater than 0. When lambda is greater than 0, what happens is, so here this is your original vector. So this is your vector V. Then when I apply the transformation, so after applying the transformation, your new vector is this. That is, it is only changing the magnitude and the direction is not changed. You can observe that. Now let's see, given a matrix and given a vector, how do we verify whether the given vector is a eigenvector or not for the given matrix? So now consider this matrix A, and we are given two vectors x1 and x2. So our job is to verify whether x1 and x2 are the eigenvectors for this matrix A or not. So how do we verify that? Basically, eigenvector, if the vector x1 is a eigenvector for the matrix A, it should satisfy the equation. So Ax1 equal to some lambda, which is a constant value, x1. So if any vector x1 that satisfies this equation, then we can say that x1 is a eigenvector for this matrix. So that is how we can check. So let's start checking for the vector x1. So Ax1 will compute. Ax1 equal to A into, so this is A basically, and this is x1. So when we apply a matrix into a vector, so then what we get is a vector, and 2 into 1 plus 0 into 0, it is 2. So 0 into 1 plus minus 1 into 0, so it is 0. So this is the vector we obtain, and then this can be converted into 2 into So we are just taking 2 out, then in that case we can write it as, so 2 into 1 and 0. So in this case, this is the vector. So to obtain in this form, so we are converting it. So lambda x1 form we need to convert. So this is the x1. So just we are converting to x1 form. So now this is your lambda and this is your x1 value. So now this can we say that this is the eigenvector or not? So because it is satisfying this equation, so Ax1 equal to, so this is lambda x1. So because it is satisfying, we can say that, so x1 is the eigenvector for the matrix A. Now let's check whether x2 is a eigenvector for the matrix A or not. So now consider Ax2 again. It has to satisfy the formula. Lambda x2. So now we will just apply Ax2, take Ax2. So A is this matrix and x2 is this vector. So then we are basically applying A into x2. So if we apply the multiplication of the vector and the matrix into vector, then what we get is a vector. So 2 into 0 plus 0 into 1, that's 0. Then 0 into 0 plus minus 1 into 1, in that case we get a minus 1. And now this vector, the resultant vector, so first to prove it is a eigenvector, so it should be converted to the form of x2 form, lambda x2 form we need to convert. So for that we are rewriting it as in the form of, so lambda, so minus 1 is the lambda here and this is of the form x2 here, so you can observe that. So now it is in the form of lambda into x2. So now we can prove that Ax2 equal to lambda x2. So this equation is satisfied. So now we can conclude that x2 is also an eigenvector for the matrix A. So this is how we can check, so whether the given vector is an eigenvector or not for the given matrix. In this case, both x1 and x2 are the eigenvectors for the matrix A. Yeah, now let's see how do we compute the eigenvectors. So given the matrix, so how do we compute? So in the previous case, we have observed given the vectors, so these are the given vectors and this is the given matrix. We just verified whether this is the eigenvector for this matrix, whether this is the eigenvector for this matrix or not, we just verified. But now, given this matrix alone, how do we compute these eigenvectors from the given matrix? Now let's see how do we compute eigenvectors and eigenvalues for the given matrix. So first we'll see what is the process, then we'll take an example and solve it out. So let A be the matrix of size n by n and then the matrix, so for the vector V being the eigenvector for the matrix A, in that case it has to satisfy this equation. So AV equal to lambda V. So this can be rewritten in this form. So you are just taking this out, so AV, so you are just moving this part to the left side. So that can be rewritten as AV minus lambda V equal to 0. And now I am rewriting it as I into V instead of V. So I am rewriting it as I into V. So when we multiply an identity matrix with the vector, then the resultant is a vector itself. So without changing the original value, so we are just multiplying it with I into V. So to make it compatible with the subtraction of AV, we are just doing that. So after doing that, so you just take out V from this. So in both the terms we have V, so you just take out V. Now this form is converted to, so we are just converting this form to this form. So now I can write it as A minus lambda I into V and this is equal to 0. So when this is equal to 0, in that case only I can say that if this is satisfied, then only I can say that, so the vector V is an eigenvector for the matrix A. So you can observe that in this case, V will get a non-zero solution if and only if the determinant of A minus lambda I is 0. In that case only, so V will be having a non-zero solution. So we are interested in identifying the determinant of A minus lambda I and we will equate that to 0 so that we will get the values of lambdas. So in this case lambda is the eigenvalue and V is the eigenvector. Once we get the eigenvalues, that is the lambda values, then we can substitute the lambda values in this equation. This is actually called as a polynomial characteristic equation, and once we get the lambda values and we can substitute the lambda values in that, and we will get the eigenvectors. And to get the eigenvalues of the matrix A, what we need to do is we need to find the roots of the characteristic polynomial equation, and this is what is called as the characteristic equation for the eigenvectors. So that is determinant of A minus lambda I equal to 0. Yeah. Now let's take the example and try to solve it. So now the given matrix, let's assume this is the matrix A. So let this is the matrix, this be the matrix A, which is of 2 by 2 dimensional. Now we are interested in identifying the eigenvalues and eigenvectors for this given matrix. So to make it simple, we are considering a 2 by 2 matrix, and the same can be extended to any size matrix. Now to get the eigenvectors and eigenvalues, so this has to satisfy the equation AB equal to lambda V, where V is the eigenvector and lambda is the eigenvalue, right? Now, so to get the solution, as we have already seen, so the determinant of A minus lambda I, it should be equated to 0. So first, let's find A minus lambda I. This is what A is minus. So you just take the lambda value. And here, because the given matrix A is of 2 by 2 dimension, so we need to take the identity matrix. Here I is the identity matrix, and we need to take the identity matrix of also the size of 2 by 2. The original matrix is of 2 by 2. That is why we are taking the eigen, the identity matrix as a 2 by 2 size. So this is the given matrix, and we are interested in finding the eigenvalues and the eigenvector V. And so to get, so for lambda being the eigenvalue and V being the eigenvector, it has to satisfy this equation AV minus lambda V. And to get the solution of lambdas and eigenvectors, so the characteristic equation, polynomial equation, has to be equated to 0. So the characteristic polynomial equation in the case of the eigenvectors is determinant of A minus lambda I. So that we need to equate that to 0. So let's identify first A minus lambda I, then later we'll see the determinant of that. So take A value, so subtract that with lambda into I. So in this case, so the unit matrix must be of 2 by 2 size, because your original matrix is also of size 2 by 2. So let's identify A minus lambda I. So 5 minus 2, 6 minus 2 minus, so this, you just multiply the scalar lambda, 0, then lambda 6. So just subtract this, now we'll get 5 minus lambda, then minus 2, then this is 6, then this is minus 2 minus lambda. So now this is the value for the A minus lambda I is. Now we need to identify det of A minus lambda I. So what is the determinant of this? How do you identify determinant of a 2 by 2 matrix? So AD minus BC. So that is how you can find the determinant of the given matrix. So the determinant of this can be written as here. It can be written as 5 minus lambda into minus 2 minus lambda minus minus 2 into 6. Now this has to be equated to 0. So this is what the determinant of A minus lambda I equal to 0. So now if we solve this, 5 minus lambda into this minus minus 2 into 6. So that is how we have written. So from here we are writing this. So now, so you can continue solving this. So 5 to 10 minus 10, then minus 5 lambda plus 2 lambda plus lambda square. Then if you continue to the next term, so it is plus 12. equal to 0. So now this can be written as, if you solve it, it is lambda square minus 3 lambda minus 3 lambda plus 2 equal to 0. Lambda square. So to find the roots of this equation, so we can rewrite it as minus lambda minus 2 lambda. So this is all the math what we have done during our 8th or 9th class math. Lambda. So you just take the lambda out of this. So lambda into lambda minus 1 minus 2 into lambda minus 1. And this is equal to 0. And now all of us know how to solve the equations. In this case, lambda minus 2 equal to 0 and lambda minus 1 into lambda minus 2 equal to 0. So in that case, you can write it as lambda equal to 1 in the first case. So by equating this term to 0, we'll get lambda equal to 1, and by equating this to 0, we'll get lambda equal to 2. So you can consider this as first eigenvalue, you can consider this as second eigenvalue. So because our matrix is of 2 by 2 dimension, we'll be getting two different eigenvalues. So our first eigenvalue is lambda 1 equal to 1, and second eigenvalue is lambda 2 equal to 2. So this is how we can compute the eigenvalues. So once we have the eigenvalues, then we can identify the eigenvectors. And now what you need to do is A minus lambda I into B equal to C. So if you solve this equation, then you will get the eigenvectors. So first we will consider the lambda value as 1, and then we will solve what is the corresponding eigenvector for this lambda. So then later on we will consider lambda 2 equal to 2, and then we will identify what is the eigenvector corresponding to lambda 2. So now let's see how to solve it. A minus lambda I equal to lambda I into B equal to 0. So we can compute A minus lambda I as, so A value is 5 minus 2, 6 minus 2 minus lambda I can be written as lambda 0, 0, lambda, and then so this can be multiplied with the vector V. So in the because this is the eigenvector we are identifying corresponding associated with the lambda 1, so we will call this as vector 1. So because this is a 2 by 2 matrix, so you will be having so V1 and V2 as two different eigenvectors associated with lambda 1 and lambda 2. So now we are interested in identifying V1, and because the 2 by 2 dimensional matrix, your eigenvector size is also of size 2. So V1 is of 2 dimensional and V2 is also 2 dimensional. So now we can consider this V1 as, we will write it as V11, V12. So now this is a vector we are interested in identifying, that is equal to 0. So now let's solve it. So we can solve it as 5 minus lambda minus 2, 6 minus 2 minus lambda, and this can be multiplied with V11, V12. So this has to be equal to 0. And when we multiply this, and we have already this lambda 1 values. We are interested in identifying the first eigenvector that is associated with the first eigenvalue. So we can substitute the lambda 1 value, that is 1. So 5 minus 1 is 4, and minus 2, then 6 minus 2 minus 1. The lambda 1 value is 1. So you can substitute the lambda 1 values here. So it will become minus 3. Minus 2 minus 1 is 3. Now you can write it as V11, V12 equal to 0. Once we are done with that, so then this can be written as 4V11 minus 2V12 equal to 0. So then we can even write the second row also, we can multiply. So 6V11, 6 into V11 minus 3 into V12 equal to 0. So if we proceed with this, so for the time being, I'll remove this part. So these are the eigenvalues we got, and So we are continuing with this, identifying the eigenvectors. So these are the two equations we got. This is the first equation and this is the second equation. So now from the first equation we can write it as 4v11 minus 2v12 equal to 2v12. So from that we can write it as v11 equal to v12 by 2. So that is from the first equation. And from the second equation also we can write it as 6v11 equal to 3v12. So this implies this, with this also we can write it as v11 equal to half into v12. So from both the equations, so from this and this, so from this both, so you can see that v11 equal to half into v12. So our eigenvector v1 can be of any vector which is of the form, so you can see v1 can be of any of the form k into, so whichever is satisfying this condition. So v11 equal to v12 by 2, that is your first element must be half of the second element. So if this is 1, then I need to consider this as 1 by 2. So now k can be any scalar value, so it can be any scalar value. So that is how we can identify the vector v1. Similarly, so if you continue with the same process by considering lambda 2 value, so we'll get the associate eigenvector associated with the lambda 2 also. The same process can be continued to identify the second eigenvector also. So this is the process involved in identifying the eigenvector and eigenvalues for the given matrix. First, what we did was, so we have taken this matrix, then we have identified the determinant of a minus lambda I, and then we have equated that to 0. So when you solve the roots of this equation, then we got these lambda 1 equal to 1 and lambda 2 equal to 2. That is, these two are the eigenvalues for this matrix. And now to get the associated eigenvectors, then what do we need to do is, so you just equate this a minus lambda I into v1 equal to 0. So if you solve this equation by substituting your lambda 1 value here, then you will get the first vector. So here when you solve this equation, so you it turned out like your v1 is of the form any scalar into the first element is half and the second element is 1, because in by solving the equation we got the terms like v11 equal to v12 by 2. So in that sense, so you are, the first element must be half of your second element. So that is how any vector which is having this form, this general form, can be of can be the eigenvector for your given matrix V. This is how we can identify, we can compute. So for the given matrix, the set of eigenvalues for the matrix and also the eigenvectors for the matrix we can identify. Now let's see some of the special matrices. So we have some, because for these kind of semi-definite matrix and positive semi-definite matrix, so the eigenvector properties changes. So that is how we are interested in some special types of matrices called as positive definite matrix and the positive semi-definite matrix. So positive definite matrix is defined as the matrix. So if you have any matrix A and for any given vector X, so if X transpose AX is greater than 0, that is if it is positive, so if you consider this value, so the resultant value will be a scalar, and this scalar value is always a positive non-zero value. In that case we can call the matrix A as a positive definite matrix. And similarly we have another special type of matrix called as semi-definite, positive semi-definite matrix, where for any vector X, so if X transpose AX is greater than or equal to 0, that is here in this case 0 is also valid, that is why we are calling it as positive semi-definite. So in this case, so this value must be greater than 0, that is it is only positive, that is why we are calling it as positive definite. So that is how positive definite and positive semi-definite matrices can be defined. These are the special types of matrices, and we are very much interested in these matrices because these matrices are having some special type of properties in the context of the eigenvectors and eigenvalues. So if you consider any positive definite matrix, then all the eigenvalues are the positive values. So that is a special property of this positive definite matrix. So in case of the regular matrices, the eigenvalues can be complex values, they can be positive values, they can be negative values also. But if you consider the positive definite matrix, in that case, if you compute the eigenvalues like lambda 1, lambda 2 and so on, lambda n, so all the values, all the eigenvalues are positive. So that is why we are interested in the positive definite matrix and the positive semi-definite matrix. Now let's see few of the properties of the eigenvectors and eigenmatrices. So eigenvectors and eigenvalues can be computed for a matrix which is of square size. That is, for the non-square, that is the rectangular matrices, eigenvectors and eigenvalues cannot be computed. So if your matrix is having equal dimensions, if it is a square matrix, then only it is possible to identify the eigenvectors and eigenvalues for the matrix. And when you compute the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors, eigenvectors need not to be unique. So they can be identical also. So they are not unique. And once you have identified vector V as a eigenvector, then KV is also a eigenvector. So in that way, eigenvectors are not unique for the given matrix. So it can be, so they can be multiple eigenvectors associated with a single eigenvalue. So if you have V as an eigenvector, then in that case, all the vectors of type KV, so where K is a constant value, so they all can be the eigenvectors for the given matrix A, which is a square matrix of size n by n. And then in that case, lambda 1 to lambda n are the eigenvalues. Assuming lambda 1 to lambda n are the eigenvalues, in that case, if you have any of these, any one of these eigenvalues as 0, in that case, so it cannot be invertible. That is, you cannot identify the inverse of the matrix. So the reason is simple. So the reason is, the determinant of A, the determinant of A is actually equivalent to the multiplication of all the eigenvalues. So you just take lambda 1 into lambda 2 into and so on. If you multiply all these eigenvalues of the matrix, that gives you the determinant of the matrix A. So if any one of these eigenvalues is 0, in that case what happens is your determinant of this matrix is 0. When the determinant of the matrix is 0, then we all know that it cannot be invertible. So the identifying the inverse of that matrix is not possible because it is a singular matrix. Now let us see some more properties of the eigenvectors and eigenvalues. So if you consider any symmetric matrix, if you consider any matrix which is symmetric and with having real values, and if you compute the eigenvalues for that, so then the eigenvalues are not complex and all the eigenvalues are real values. So if you consider any real symmetric matrix, for that matrix all the eigenvalues are real and they are not complex. So if you consider a non-symmetric matrix, then there is a chance of having the eigenvalues as complex values also. Then if a matrix is a non-singular value and all the eigenvalues are non-zero. So we already discussed one property related to the eigenvalues. So product of all the eigenvalues is equivalent to the determinant of the matrix. In that case, if any one of the eigenvalue is 0, your determinant of the matrix is 0. In that case, your matrix is a singular matrix. So if your matrix is a non-singular matrix, that implies that all the eigenvalues are non-zero. If the matrix is a positive definite matrix, we just discussed previously what positive definite matrix is. So any matrix A can be positive semi-definite positive definite matrix if X transpose AX, for any x value, if this quantity is greater than 0, you can call it as a positive definite matrix. If the matrix A is a positive definite matrix, then if you identify the eigenvalues, then all the eigenvalues are positive. So they are not negative. If you consider the eigenvectors corresponding to different eigenvalues, then all of them are orthogonal to each other. Now, let us see what is diagonalization of the matrix. So first we will see what the diagonal matrix is, and then we will discuss how to identify diagonalization of the matrix and why we are interested in the diagonalization of the matrix, we will discuss shortly. So any matrix which is having the non-zero elements on the main diagonal and zero elements on the of the diagonal. Such a matrix is called as a diagonal matrix. If you observe here, this is an n by n matrix, and only on the principal diagonal or the main diagonal you have non-zero elements. And on the of the diagonal, you can see all these values are zero values. Only at this location, so you have the non-zero values. In case of the diagonal matrices, it is very convenient to compute the eigenvalues. Now let's see how it is easy. So when you consider any matrix, this is an example for the diagonal matrix, and when you want to compute the eigenvalues for this matrix, so whatever the non-zero elements that are on the diagonal, so these are the non-zero elements on the diagonal, so these values will be your eigenvalues. In that case, you need not to perform any computation to identify the eigenvalues. Now I can say my first lambda 1, that is eigenvalue, first eigenvalue is minus 1, and similarly I can see lambda 2 is 2, so this becomes my second eigenvalue, my third eigenvalue, and my fourth eigenvalue. So that is how whatever the values that are available on the diagonal which are non-zero, they becomes your eigenvalue. Simply you just identify the non-zero elements on the diagonal, and that makes your eigenvalues. So there is no computation, right? Earlier, so for a given matrix which is non-diagonal, so we had to take lot of steps. That is how you can compute the eigenvalues for the given diagonal matrix. Then how to compute the eigenvectors? So if you consider, so the coordinate, the ith coordinate vector for the corresponding Aii will be the eigenvector for the corresponding eigenvalue. For example, for this eigenvalue, your eigenvector can be something like, you know, it is 1, 0, because your given matrix is 4 by 4, so your eigenvector also should have 4 values, and this is the first one, so that is how this is the given the matrix A of n by n size. So let's see how to convert that matrix to the diagonal matrix. And this process of converting any given matrix to the diagonal matrix is called as diagonalization of the matrix. This diagonalization is possible under the assumption that, so the matrix A, which is a square matrix of size n by n, and it must be having n linearly independent eigenvectors. So with that assumption only, a matrix can be converted to the diagonal matrix. Now let us see how to convert the matrix into diagonal matrix. So given the matrix A, which is of size n by n, we need to find the matrix P such that, so if we can write P inverse into A into P, so the product of three different matrices is equal to a lambda, then so this lambda will be the resultant diagonal matrix is represented by this lambda, the capital lambda symbol, and this P inverse into A, this is the matrix multiplication of three different matrices. A is the original matrix, and we need to understand how can we formulate this P inverse and the matrix P. Once we have the matrix P, we can easily identify the P inverse matrix. P can be formulated with the help of the n eigenvectors, which are the linearly independent eigenvectors. So let's assume v1 to vn are the n eigenvectors corresponding to the given matrix A. Now you can formulate P using these vectors as the column vectors, columns of the matrix P. So if you can formulate that, so your P is ready. Once you have P, you can find the P inverse of that matrix. So you have P inverse, you have A, the given matrix, and P is the matrix that is formulated with the n eigenvectors as the columnar vectors, columns of the matrix P. And if you apply the matrix multiplication of all these three, then the resultant matrix is a diagonal matrix. So how we are getting this diagonal matrix is, so when you consider formulating the eigenvector, so for the given matrix, any vector if you multiply, and that becomes the eigenvector if and only if it satisfies the equation Av equal to lambda v. So this is for a single vector, and if you extend that to multiple matrices, multiple eigenvectors, where P is the matrix that is formulated with the eigenvectors, you can consider A into P equal to this P into the matrix that is formulated with all the eigenvalues as the diagonal elements. And now if you move this P to the left side, then it becomes P inverse. Then P inverse AP is equal to the diagonal matrix. So that is how you will get the diagonal matrix when you multiply this P inverse into A into P. Let us see how do we convert the given matrix to the diagonal matrix. So this is the given matrix A, which is of 2 by 2 dimensional, with the elements as 1 as the elements. So 1 1 1 1 as the row vectors of the matrix. Then so we already know how to identify the eigenvalues and the corresponding eigenvectors for the given matrix. Now in this case we have identified the eigenvalues as 0 and 2, and also the corresponding eigenvectors are v1 and v2 with the values 1, minus 1 and 1, 1. Now we have the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Once we have them, then we can formulate P by placing v1 as the first column in the P matrix, v2 as the second column in the matrix P. Now this is the P matrix. Once we have this matrix P, we can find the P inverse. So we know already how to identify the inverse of the matrix. Now P inverse is available, P is available, this is the given matrix. So all the three matrices are available for us, and if you apply the matrix multiplication of these three matrices, what is the resultant matrix? Is the resultant matrix is the diagonal matrix. So that is how, given the matrix, given any matrix, you can convert the matrix into diagonal matrix, and this process of converting the matrix to the diagonal matrix is called as diagonalization of the matrix.
Yeah.
So with this,